your time has come. Pretty yellow bird fly. All right, 27 minutes before 10 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in this Thursday morning. Pretty busy today. I guess because tomorrow's the 4th of July. It's kind of a mixture of people trying to get everything done, right? And looking forward to the fact that nothing needs to be done tomorrow.
Exactly.
Shea Rose is on the phone, and she has written a book. It's called The Altar Call. It is described as a satirical comedy through which the protagonist experiences spiritual enlightenment.
Yes.
Right? That's like putting peanut butter with turkey or something, isn't it?
Yeah.
Shea is a poet, a musician and composer. I guess that would mean songwriter, right? When you write words and music. she's, obviously, an author, and she's on the phone, and she sounds delightful. Let's say hi to her on the air. Good morning, Shea. How are you?
Hello.
How are you? Can you hear me?
I'm fine, and yourself? Yes, I can hear you.
Could you not hear the intro, by the way? I'm just a kind of a note for myself.
No, I did not hear the intro.
Okay, see, something is different with our system here. Well, I just gave you a glowing intro.
Yes, he did.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you so very much. I'm sorry I missed it.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. I something happened that I don't know exactly what it is, but I guess the phone lines only work when we're on the air. But we sound okay now, right? You sound good to us, so.
Okay.
All right.
No, you're still coming across a little squawky, but.
Oh, squawky.
Oh
yeah.
Well, I found out that the Sasquatch turns out that the DNA, it turns out, is from raccoons or something. So I'm just teasing.
I'm sorry, I just don't know a better word for this.
No, that's good. That's good. So where are you right now? Did I ask? I'm confused a little bit here. Where are you?
I'm in New Jersey.
In New Jersey. Okay. Robin has
Somerset, New Jersey.
Where is it?
Somerset, New Jersey.
Oh, Somerset. Robin has a son who lives in Jersey.
Bloomfield.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. It's
one of those things that technology can't replace. You can't replace locating somebody and figuring out if they live near somebody you know.
That's right.
That's true. Hello, Robin. I didn't realize I was speaking to you when you answered the phone.
Oh, again, good morning.
Thank you both for having me.
And and you've got a storm coming your way, so we better hurry up and get this done before you get that thing Arthur coming your way, right?
Yeah, that's true.
You had enough of a storm. Was it 1 year ago, Sandy? Was it Sandy?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it was.
Wow.
Absolutely. No, 2 years.
2 years. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Let's hope this doesn't repeat, Sandy. So tell me about your work as well. Let's talk about the book first. The book is called The Altar Call. Tell me about the book.
Yes, it's a book about a stormy relationship that ended horribly, but I ultimately learned a lot from that relationship.
You did.
The fact that it went right. Yes, I did.
Oh, this is a true story.
This is a true story.
Okay.
And it wasn't, again, millions of people have love stories gone wrong, billions of people, and there always will be. But the bottom line for me was the takeaway from it, which was the beginning of my spiritual development and evolution. And also putting into practice things that I had learned in college but never really paid that much attention to, particularly in my psychology courses. And Freud, to be just on point, was very on point with the fact of how the personality has three components and how all those components influence our life or does not influence our lives. So as per Freud, he developed the theories of personality, which are the ego, the id, and the superego. And the ego is the part of our personality that deals with reality. It's based on our five senses, and it leads us to making our reality-based decisions. Then you have the superego, which is basically our moral compass. It's the last part of the personality to develop, and it gives us our sense of right and wrong. But it's also based on values of other people, like your parents, your peer groups, and it develops over time. So it's ultimately the last part of the personality to develop. But the id is something entirely different. The id I have deemed as inner divinity, because it's the only part, as per Freud, of the personality that's present from birth.
Ah.
And it's the source of all psychic energy. It's what connects us to, however you're comfortable with calling it, your higher being. It's the only piece of the personality that connects us with God, the universe, source, the Almighty, and it's present from birth.
Now,
Do
you consider that a belief or a knowledge? Do you believe that, but you can't absolutely say it's a truth, or do you Do you feel like that's absolutely the truth? It really is knowledge, the whole id theory.
I believe it's absolute truth. And the reason being is because it also connects with something in the Bible. And I didn't even know Freud was somebody who would read the Bible. And I'm not saying he did or did not. But what I found in the book of Deuteronomy, which is the fifth chapter of the Old Testament, chapter 30, verse 19, speaks to God talking to Moses and telling him to deliver this message to the Israelites who are just about to go into the promised land after wandering around the wilderness for 40 years. And God said, tell these people that I will call together heaven and earth to witness against them that I have set before them life and death. Choose life so that you and your children may live prosperously in the new land. And I kept thinking, what is this heaven and earth? What is heaven and earth called to witness against the people?
Yeah, really.
What does that mean?
Yeah, what does it mean?
And then thinking further, when you apply that to the principles that Freud came out with, the ego and the superego would be the earthly part. The id would be your inner divinity or your psychic energy, the source piece. So those are the heaven and earth pieces that I believe God was talking about. And he says, choose life so that you may live prosperously in the land. Well, here's the other thinking to that. It's like the id is telling you to do A, B, C, but your ego and superego suggest you do X, Y, Z. The choice you have to make is between the id and your human-based self. If you go with human stuff, you're typically going to end up in a ditch. But when you get a divine inspiration about something, you're going to end up in a better place. That's the life versus death.
You know, I love what you're saying. I love where you're taking us with this, and I love your thinking. The one thing I've often thought, though, is when you say you end up in a better place, let's just focus on that just for a second, because I love what you just said. However, my definition of a better place may not be the same as somebody else's.
Correct.
For example, if I have a divine inspiration to, I mean, you're a songwriter, so you might have a divine inspiration to write a song. And I've known many people who've had this. You know, if it's, I felt I was just driving my car, all of a sudden it hit me and I had to hurry up and write the song or this book or whatever, or make them right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. There it is. It's done. And you are in this glow, this divine glow, but there's not a penny added to your bank account. And so while your definition of success might be realized with that experience, somebody else's isn't. And it's the world, I think, that sometimes makes very successful people who don't have much financially feel like they are not successful. It is the world. And the world betrays us in this way, I think. Because how many people do we revere now who died poor? Thomas Jefferson is one of them, by the way. I don't know how many people know. Thomas Jefferson died broke. Was it Robert Frost? Did he die broke?
Yeah.
I can't remember. Was it Robert Frost?
Yeah, he did.
No, the guy who wrote the Swanee River song.
Oh.
who wrote the Swanee River song?
I can't remember his name.
I can't remember.
Way down.
Stephen Foster.
Yeah, he died broke.
There you go.
Right?
Okay.
So,
mm-hmm.
So anyway, I just wanted to throw that in there, that our own idea of what is successful varies from one person to the next.
It absolutely does. But because they die broke doesn't mean they didn't achieve their mission or their purpose in life.
Right.
And listening to your inner divinity is something that is God-given to you. It's the gift. It's the treasure that's within. And whatever that treasure is, and you actually get to recognize and realize it, then you have far more wealth than just the material stuff, because bottom line is we are all going back to the dirt, you know, mm-hmm. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust.
Yeah, yeah.
And
so we're not, but the contribution, the legacy that these poor men died, the legacy they left was tremendous.
Right, right.
And
so they may have not have realized the money from it, but their name lives on.
And two of your personalities in the book, the married black police officer and the unhappily married white rabbi, they have to come together to form a union to help your third character.
Well, they never came together. They were my advisors. They never mm-hmm. met each other. They just were giving me, it was like they were on my left and my right hand. They were both very vastly different people, but their advice was very similar.
So you are Danielle then?
Yes.
You are Danielle. Okay.
Yes.
So what was your relationship that fell apart? Was it a romantic relationship?
Yes, it was. It was an intense one. And I just wanted to have this man at all costs because he just represented everything that I thought I wanted. But I didn't really know the person. I knew what I wanted with him, but I didn't really know who he was. And at the core, we were very different people.
How come you didn't know him? I mean, is this somebody you were dating?
Yes, it was. Well, you know, people lie.
Yes, I know that.
You know, people lie.
Yeah.
As Chris Rock has said, you know, people send out their representatives to meet you before you actually meet the actual person. And again, intuitively, I knew things are wrong here. This is just not the way a good relationship should go. But on the other hand, he took me to Paris, to Africa. We would just go back and forth to California just because he could.
Oh, wow. So he was a rich guy. I mean,
so, well, he was pretty well off. And I just kept thinking, yeah, well, I can fix this. Whatever is wrong, I can fix this. But some things you can't. As the Bible also says, be ye not unequally yoked together. There are just some things you cannot fix. And when you get that powerful message from within, and when you're having this struggle from within that's saying, get out, and you're not listening, you're doing yourself a disservice. That's having chosen death. Not life.
So when we have a relationship with somebody and it goes wrong, we often take whatever we learned from that person about that person and we apply it to the entire gender that that person belongs to. I mean, men do this and women do this. We'll say, you know, you can't trust women anymore. I already went through one relationship. Well, one relationship isn't the whole planet.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And I've often thought this, when men will complain about women or when women will complain about men, I will always say, why are you complaining? You don't have to find every one. You just have to find one.
Yeah.
The one. Exactly.
Yeah. So was that a realization of your own, or did you go the direction of just swearing off all men for all time?
Oh, no. What I believe happened to me with this relationship was this was a catalyst for something bigger for me. This was a relationship that brought me to my spiritual connection. It brought me to focus on my inner divinity. And it didn't leave me with any perception about men globally. This was, and the reason I entitled the book, The Altar Call, because this was truly about me. It was about getting me to not focus on human-based desires, but focus on the things, the gifts that I've been given. And I don't need a man to help me realize that, or anyone else. I just need to do what I should be doing as part of my mission or as my mission here on Earth.
Yeah, I believe that's true, too. Wow, you're pretty wise. But now let me ask you this part. If I listen to a stand-up comic and I'm laughing at something, a lot of times the biggest laughs comes from the things that they've said that are observational things that are absolutely dead on true. Mm-hmm. And so they're absolutely true. They're focusing on a truth that when said a certain way rings as funny. It's almost as if some of the wisest people among us are those who are making us laugh.
Could be. That's their gift.
But isn't it your gift too? Isn't that part of what you do as well?
I don't know that I make people laugh. The story itself, the book is pretty funny. People who have read it said, my gosh, some of these things that you went through and they're so blatantly disastrous but comical also, and you didn't get out from that. And I said no, because my human self said, but I can fix this. So I stayed, and you know, I've given some laughs here and there, but I don't know if that's my true purpose.
So isn't that funny? Who was the author we're speaking to that decided to go into comedy because people kept laughing? He didn't think it was funny at all. Was it Rob Carl Reiner.
Reiner. Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he told us something similar, that early in his life, he was just, you know, being himself, and everybody laughed, no matter what he did.
Yeah.
He's a serious guy.
That was his gift. Yeah, that was his treasure.
Interesting.
Did you go through periods of denial, though, before you finally accepted that you were being, quote-unquote, called?
I was always in denial until the light switched on and I realized that I needed to wake up and change. I needed to let this go, leave this alone. This wasn't working. It wasn't what I thought it should be. It never was going to be. Yeah, so I was in denial a lot. I think a lot of people, and especially as a female, we're nurturing, mm-hmm. and we tend to think we can fix this, and absolutely we cannot. So yes, I was in denial.
Hmm. And are you still, you know, Robin has this theory, by the way, that women make the mistake of trying to change men.
Yeah, they do.
I believe that. Yeah, I did. And I thought by confronting this person with the truth, it would work. We could make things work. It only got worse.
So do you think that's why men look for the perfect woman and women just look for a guy because they can fix it?
Yeah.
So we win on this deal because we can be crazy, sloppy, and just a mess. And you'll say, you know what? He's not so bad. I think I could help him lose weight get him to stop smoking. And I can even get him to stop turning his head when other women walk by. Good luck with that one.
Yeah. That's not happening.
Yeah, that's not
happening. Yeah, I can fix that, right? Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty funny stuff right there. I mean, these are the things you point out some stuff in the book, or maybe you help us understand what you went through. And it's kind of weird that somebody's telling a very serious story about themselves and we're laughing at it. But you have a way of writing that way. Maybe that's why I took it to be intentional.
I kind of say it was what it was. All of this is true. So I may have an ability to write it the way it came across and makes people laugh, and that's a good thing, as long as they're learning from something that I went through. And that when you're hearing from yourself, it's always reliable. It's always reliable.
Shea Rose is our guest. Her book is called The Altar Call. I want to ask a little bit about some of the other things in your list of credentials here. But the book, The Altar Call, is a satirical comedy. So it's listed as a comedy here, through which the protagonist experiences spiritual enlightenment. This protagonist is Danielle Winters. And it sounds like that is Shea Rose. Sounds like it's you. Okay, now we understood that. So why didn't you write it as a memoir? Why did you write it as a novel?
I believe that, again, was part of my divine inspiration to do it this way. Even the cover of the book, it was a different cover at one time. And I got, again, the inspiration to change the cover to what it is today. And on the cover of the book is a bust, a female bust, draped in a scarf. And it's symbolic that we all, even though we're naked as can be out there in the world, we always have a protective covering. And that covering is our id. It is our inner divinity, the connection to psychic energy, to source, the creator, to your higher being. So follow it.
You know, if what you're saying is absolutely true, then it answers a question we were asking actually yesterday. Are we born as a blank slate, or do we actually enter this world with some personality traits, something, some kind of anything at all? Obviously, language and a lot of the speaking accent and a lot of things that become us aren't really us. But it sounds like what you're saying is we are not a blank slate when we're born.
No. According to Freud, the only part of our personality that is present from birth is that psychic energy. It is the id. And also in the Bible, in the book of Romans, which is in the New Testament, it speaks to the fact that God foreknew you before you were even born. Mm-hmm. And for those that he foreknew, he predestinated. And those that he predestinated, he called. And those that he called, he justified. And those that he justified, he glorified. And when all those things are for you, who can be against you? So again, that speaks to what you already come into this world with.
Even though the two men helped you, did you help each of them in some fashion?
I'm not sure. I don't know. I think their purpose at the time they were in my life was to be there to help me get an understanding of what I was dealing with. We had very interesting connections. One was a coworker also, and the other was a guy I was writing music with. So we shared, the one I was writing music with, we shared, in that regard, perhaps we did help each other. I wrote lyrics and vocals and did the vocals to his music tracks. And the other guy was my coworker, which we were in different areas altogether. So I don't know that I helped him other than just being a shoulder for him to cry on. His wife, the rabbi, his wife was pretty bizarre too. And he would always say to me, you see what it means to end up with somebody who's just totally out of their mind? And that's what he was saying about this character that I was involved with, that he's doing all these things for you because he can. It doesn't really mean what you think it means.
Oh, that's extremely fascinating.
It is. It was fascinating. I didn't know what I was going through at that time.
You know, it is interesting to wonder if we have an effect on somebody else that we've run into. The movie that comes to mind is, of course, that Christmas movie, It's a Wonderful Life,
mm-hmm.
you know, where he dies, and I guess he dies or whatever, and he's shown by these angels what would have happened without, how people would have been without him. And you know, it's always this wonder. I'm not telling you I know this because I don't know this, but if I were to believe some things that we've heard, is that when you die and you go, you're standing before God, God will review your life. And as he reviews your life, you see the people you've been with and you see what you've contributed to them and you feel whatever it is that they felt because of you, whether it's pain or pleasure. If you've done something good for somebody, you feel, wow, I really did a good job. But if you're Hitler, you're probably still standing there, probably still taking the lashes after all of you. Do you know what I mean? All the people he hurt or anybody who hurt anybody feels the pain. So I just think we all contribute to somebody, whether we know it or not. And hopefully it's in a good thing and not a bad thing.
Yeah, I believe we all touch each other's lives, people we come into contact with. There's another saying that somewhat leads to that, which is people are in your life for a reason, season, or lifetime, you know. And
Right.
So that, to me, is kind of along the same track, that you're there to help somebody. It's the reason piece. You're there to help somebody for a specific thing, and that person is gone the minute the reason has been accomplished.
Shia.
A season. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I'm sorry. I just looked at your website. Is that you on the Little Warrior cover?
I don't believe so.
With the wild hair? The wild fireworks hair?
No, I hope
naked.
Not.
Naked? Are you naked?
No, not at all. No, that's not me.
Who is that? Look at that. It looks like fireworks coming out of her hair. But she's naked. Robin, do you see what I'm talking about? Look at the picture. See. I went to the website, shearose.com.
Oh, wow.
Who is that?
Look at that.
I don't have a website like that.
Wait a minute. What is your website? Shearose.com, right?
No.
Oh, that's not your web. What is your website?
No, I don't have one done at this time. Okay. So that is not me.
Uh-oh.
Well, there's another Shea Rose out there, and she's got fireworks coming out of her hair.
Yes, she
is. Oh, my gosh. Well, I know there's someone who sings, and she has, but she's called Shea Rose.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So I am Shea Rose.
So you don't have I can't look at you anywhere online? Where are you on here?
Well, actually, you won't ever see my picture.
How come?
And that's intentional. This book is part of a higher project. It is part of the Shea Rose LLC. And what we're doing is we're putting together a company that empowers women to be their divine selves, whether they're married, single, ethnicity is no issue. Just women who have become enlightened and gone on to make their lives better, either with their families or single. And we are doing this corporation as part of a movement forward. And it's not about any one particular person. It was my story, but anyone could have had this story.
You are a wise woman. I really can see what you're talking about, and I really admire what you're doing. I think you are making a huge difference for the people who you come in contact with. And I think the two men that we referred to earlier probably felt that and experienced it as well. Have you let me give away the copy I have. I wish we had more time. I want to say so many more things to you, Shia.
Thank you.
I have a copy of The Altar Call. And let me ask the listeners, if I have one out there who wants the book or more than one. I only have one book, actually. But go ahead and call me at 622-9622 and I'll put the book aside for you. The rest of us have to go buy it. Shia, that's what we need to know. How do we buy the book?
You can go to Amazon.com or BarnesandNoble.com, and of course the publisher, who is Author House.
Okay, and do you have a Facebook presence?
Yes, we do, and it is Shia Rose LLC on Facebook.
And is your picture there?
No, we want to make every woman out there a Shia Rose.
So you can't change men. Men want to know what you look like. Especially after seeing that firework-headed lady.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, my gosh. We have to do something about that. Again, that is Shay Rose. That's not Shia Rose.
All right, I got it. But your name is spelled the same, just so people know how to spell
it. Yes, it's spelled the same, correct.
All right. Well, you're a delight to talk to, and I really, truly mean it. I think you're a very wise and profound woman.
Thank you so very much.
I wish I could hear your music. There's so many more things I want to know. I know the phone is beeping, but we got to go. Shia Rose, thank you so much for being on the air with us today.
And thank you so very much for having me, Larry and Robin.
Great interview. Come back. All right, we'll take a little break. We'll be right back.
This is WOCA, Ocala, Gainesville, The Villages, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, The Source.
Fox News Radio, I'm Karen McHugh. The economy adds jobs in June as the unemployment rate drops.
Five straight months of job growth of at least 200,000 jobs. June coming in, according to the Labor Department, with 288,000 jobs added. The unemployment rate falling to 6.1%, the lowest it's been since September of 2008.
Fox Business Network's Rich Edson. Hurricane Arthur is headed for the North Carolina coast. Sustained winds of 75 miles per hour, pushing a storm surge ahead of the first hurricane of the season. Landfall is expected about midnight. A mandatory evacuation orders in place for Hatteras Island.
This poses a huge problem because there's only one road that goes in and out of the Outer Banks here, so all those residents need to get out as soon as possible before Hurricane Arthur arrives.
Fox's Michelle Macaluso. Wine lovers relax. A wildfire burning through Northern California's Napa Valley has grown to nearly 4,000 acres, but fire officials say the flames are moving away from the wineries. Fox News. We report. You decide.
Napa supports the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund, and this month we're making it easy for you to show your support too. Make any $25 purchase and you'll receive a free Napa racing cap. For every cap we give out, we'll donate a dollar to the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund, supporting those who serve you. That's Napa know-how. At participating Napa Auto Parts stores while supplies last. Offer expires 7/31/14.
Sunday on Lifetime. Past secrets always come knocking.
Someone came through that portal.
Darkness.
He betrayed us once and can never trust him.
Is.
This is all some sort of payback.
Rising.
You have powers now. Use them.
Witches of East End. New season. Sunday at 9, 8 central on.
Today in Florida Ag News, I'm a Southeast Agnet. You've heard us talk recently on just how important pollinators are, especially to agriculture.
Pollinators are important around the whole nation, and Florida is very important for the survival of particularly the European honeybees around the nation. During the winter, almost 500,000 hives are overwinter here in Florida, or they bring them in to the state. And yet they will move them out of the state during the spring and summer, going as far as California and Maine, and then they return back again to the state. So our honeybees are another Florida snowbird.
That's Mimi Williams, state agronomist and plant material specialist with USDA's Natural Resources Conservation Service in Florida. She said they are doing their part in helping pollinators, as through the Environmental Quality Incentives Program, or EQIP, they are targeting $300,000 for conservation practices to help reverse the loss of pollinator food and habitat.
Such things as conservation cover, field borders, and hedgerow planting.
She said if a producer would like to put in one of those specific conservation practices, they would have to have supporting practices.
Such as pest management, maybe a fence to keep the cattle out of their field borders or their hedgerows or something like that.
But if interested, William says you need to sign up soon.
The sign-up deadline is going to be July 18th, and what they need to do is contact their local field office.
So again, for more information on how you can help pollinators, just contact your local USDA service center.
What if you had to worry less about white mold on your peanut crop? What if white mold wasn't top of mind every single day of the season? What if you could treat it and forget it? What if there was something out there that just worked? In 2015, you won't have to wonder any longer. Research shows that with the latest from Syngenta, white mold will be managed better than ever before because of a new active ingredient. Coming soon. Contact your Syngenta agronomist to find out more about the potential for your peanuts in 2015. The latest is not yet registered for sale or use in the United States and is not being offered for sale.
Randall Wiseman, Southeast, AgNet.
Now is the time to take advantage of Florida Credit Union's CD specials. Our 36-month CD comes in at 1.26% APY. A 24-month is working for you at 1.0% APY. And our 12-month at 0.75% APY. All CD rate specials require a $10,000 minimum. With friendly service and rates like these, it's not hard to see why Florida Credit Union has your CD options covered. Florida Credit Union, connecting your money to your life. Call 352-237-8222 for more information. Must act by 1-15-14.
Hi, I'm Yvette, and I'm here to tell you a few things about ABC Frederick's Appliance. They sell not only new, but used guaranteed appliances. When you call ABC Frederick's Appliance, they will provide service on what they sell and any appliances that you own. ABC Frederick's Appliance is located in Bellevue, right over the railroad tracks. Call 352-629-5181. That's 352-629-5181. That's 352-629-5181. ABC Frederick's Appliance.
Ocala's Information Station, 1370 WOCA.
Ocala!